We've assembled a fine group here to talk to you about digital enterprise based on their experience. I'm going to let them introduce themselves. The format of this panel basically is we would like to spend a bit of time, something like 20 minutes, 25 minutes maybe, talking about their experience and then give you the opportunity to basically ask your questions. As this nice lady, I was saying. Or we open the Twitter thing as well, right? So if you're shy, you don't want to raise your hand and say something, the other opportunity for you is to actually put that question on Twitter and the team will be watching the feed and will ask the question on your behalf, basically. So I'll just pass the, you have one microphone behind you, maybe? There you go, ladies first. Gina, you'd like to introduce yourself?
Why?
Ladies first.
My name is Gina Keune. I'm from the Royal Automobile Association of South Australia, or that's RAA. Shall I do? I'm the team lead for integration and configuration. At RAA, we started with no integration platform. I came to work for them in 2013. And in 2014, I introduced the concept of maybe we need one. There are a lot of projects that we've got. Integration is only one pillar of that project. We've got a digital strategy, which is another pillar, and also a data strategy. And integration is the underpinning technology for, or the underpinning platform for that one.
Hi, my name is Conrad. I'm from LOLC Group. We are one of the largest conglomerates in the country, and I function as a CIO of the group as well as CEO of a IT company which is called LOLC Technologies.
Hi, I'm Chandika, Mendis, head of engineering slash CTO slash chief geek for Virtusa. Virtusa is an IT consulting organization headquartered in Boston. We have branches in Sri Lanka and India as well as Europe and many other European countries. So my role, when it comes to digital transformation, I look at two aspects. One is when it comes to our clients, a lot of our clients are undergoing digital transformation exercises, and me and my teams do get involved in those engagements very heavily, particularly when it comes to some of the new technologies as well as some of the strategy kind of discussions. And the second part of my role is when it comes internal, we are really trying to make use of digital technologies internally in terms of enabling our workforce, our engineers. So there's a lot of enablement that we can do. We figured out that there's a lot of areas that we can improve, making use of digital technologies internally as well. So it's kind of an exciting journey for us.
Hi, Ramesh, Shanmuganathan from John Keells. I act as the Executive Vice President and Group CIO. As you know, John Keells is diversified into seven sectors, into 80 businesses, and currently grosses about $800 million in turnover. And 14% of the market cap, probably maybe second to Virtusa if it gets listed in Sri Lanka. But as you would appreciate, I think probably from last 2 days deliberations, when we have a wide spread of businesses who earns margins ranging from 20% to 1%, unifying them on a common platform in digitalization is a challenge, right? And probably in ensuing discussions, I'll contribute to that. I'll leave park discussion at the moment. So our digitalization journey in two sense probably started when our deputy chairman got his hands on an iPad in 2010, right? So obviously like we did day-to-day digitalization stuff in terms of automation. But the challenge came when he came and said, how do I access my email on this iPad, right? And we were running Lotus Notes, as you know, very traditional legacy infrastructure. Right, that was in way back in 2010. So today, 6 years hence, we are on O365 on the cloud with 4,500 mailboxes. I think probably first in the region to move to O365, including the collaborative platform, SharePoint, OneDrive, Link. And today, every one of our employees with a mobile device and internet access could be truly be working from any part of the world. right, in terms of employee-centric services. And that's the enablement that we've achieved over the last 5 years. And it was not an easy journey, right? And I don't want to delve into the details because I don't think I'll have the time. But specifics in terms of that whole journey is in terms of people having a vision in terms of what do you want to see in the future. And enablement in terms of employee being productive, right? Where you don't want them wasting time in terms of wanting to do basic stuff, right? And how quickly could you enable them? Because if the employees are not enabled, I don't think any digitalization journey would be a success.
Okay, our journey actually little bit different because we grew by acquisition as a group. So we have different challenges with different systems in all over different companies. So we are with O365 in some context, but some organizations differ, has different needs. So especially when it comes to the financial services sector, we have moved several steps further away from in terms of the technology, what is the digitalization platform. Today our clients, being a non-banking financial services, not like a bank, even in a banking sector, you don't have mobile-based banking, very few companies have it. We have gone on a different direction and we have enabled our customers to transact anytime, anywhere, even any day from the mobile device using our mobile platform. So that's a different experience. But it's just a journey, it's a start of a journey, I would say, for that sector. So the other sectors are in different levels. And we have a complete different vision in terms of using the digital platform for rest of the organization. For example, we are into leisure sector. The leisure sector is in a different level of customers that we are dealing with. So we are at a different level of digitization process. Again, coming back to banking sector, we have a different vision where we have engaged in a project totally developing what Asanka said, a digital platform for the banking sector, which we believe that it is quite a challenging one. There are quite challenges that which you have faced so far, and probably I'll share with next with regards to the challenges. But our vision there is to create a platform and, which is enabling all the not only the customers, but giving the digital experience to our employees, customers, and partners, and who are connecting with our systems. That's where we are in terms of our financial services sector.
For us at RIA, for me in particular, one of the biggest challenges we had when we started to look at integration products in the market was whether to go for commercial products for integration or open source or a combination of subscription and stuff like that. The first time I actually had a conversation from WSO2, the question, this was the statement that Michael Helm, our account person, said to me. Because I was asking, can you give me some indicative pricing of how much we're going to spend? Because usually commercial integration products are like that. You have to know how much it is. And then he goes and says to me, oh, well, you can download our products, the full of it, and you can test it for free on our website. And I was like, you know, we were in a meeting and I was writing down because expecting a number to come out of his mouth. And I said, say that again? You download the product for free, a working product? I said, yeah. It's like, and then I actually didn't believe him. So I said, can you send me the link? Because I actually didn't see it. So that was my first experience with WSO2. It was really, really surreal for me because the last integration project I had before RIA, we spent about, you know, maybe I shouldn't say it, but I'll say it anyway, keep it to ourselves, 1.6 million for a proof of concept. That's not productionalizing. So, so you could just imagine my, really? So we did that, we downloaded it. Of course, I didn't have the infrastructure to actually test it. I do have my own development platform in the cloud, but that's mine because I'm a software developer by night, by day I'm at work. So I did all the downloads and I did some simple stuff. And yeah, that was the first shock to my system. I did the ESB then, the ESB component. So I was happy with it. And the person that I am, I don't actually recommend products unless I know they actually work, because I've got my name and my integrity down the line. So that's where we started. And basically, the patterns, I identified patterns that are existing in the company at the moment when I actually started there. And then I had a few more analysis that I did. But basically, the hard part is really trying to figure out which WSO2 components should go together. And basically, that boils down to the requirements of the business. And if you don't know what you're solving or what your problem is, then you have no hopes trying to figure out what the WSO2 components would be. But a good place to start would be the ESB, because that's basically, in anything, our experience with the ESB was that when we did the proof of concept for our use case, we had one application which was doing an XML pass-through and not doing it the standard way. And we were getting stuck because ESB was trying to get it the standard way and it wasn't doing it. But, and then we told the vendor, you're not doing it standard. And the vendor said, yes, we are. And then we said, no, you're not. And then we had to prove it to them. But that didn't stop us, because we still were able to configure the ESB to work around the problem. And it worked. So it's a lot of experimenting, evaluating. But I guess with any other product, you gain confidence once you see it working. And if you see it working, then it's easier to tell people about it. And my advice is basically, before you actually say that it works, before you actually propose it to your management group, make sure it works. So, because then if there's an argument whether or not it doesn't work or doesn't work, you can actually show them. It's easy to show them rather than to tell them.
Hey, so if you look at Virtusa, we are in a pretty unique place. Last time we counted, 86% of our population were millennials. So what that means is there's a very different set of expectations when people come into the company. Those days, I think, when we, some time back, you had very slow connection at home and, dial-up modem or whatever, they have no broadband. And you come to office and or university, you get a fast connection, right? And you're very happy. And now it's the opposite, right? People have very fast connections at home. When they come into office, everything is blocked. There's a very protective kind of environment because there's a lot of data leakage concerns and all of that. So we really wanted to make sure that they get that Sunday night experience on Monday morning when they come into office. So part of our first part of our digital strategy was to make sure that they get a similar experience. So all of the best practices from what's out there in terms of their digital experience, in terms of, they're on YouTube trying to learn something or publish some thing that they learned. They're on LinkedIn, they're on all of these different technologies and platforms, and create a similar platform internally for our end users. So and that's the first part of it. And if you look at our population, we have a lot of developers, being an IT services company. So the next question was, how do we really create compelling experiences for them, which really impacts them at a individual level? So for example, an activity that they regularly do is checking in code. How can you make that an engaging experience? So the moment somebody checks in code, we do an analysis. Immediately they get feedback on whether the code was good or bad. All of those are small experiences that go a long way to creating a really exciting digital experience. And that goes a long way for us from a business objectives perspective, because we want to make sure that everybody who comes on board gets onboarded, gets to a certain standard very quickly, they're motivated and highly engaged in the work that they're doing for our clients, right? So all of this is something that is part of our digital journey. And then you have different audience in terms of the people on site. Now they have different sets of challenges, right? People who go to client sites, they don't come into office every day and they're not connected to the office network. They have a set of different challenges. time entry is a challenge for them. So there are certain specific things. Expenses is a challenge for them. How can you enable some of those use cases, user journeys, from a digital device, from the digital device that they do carry? Now, it all seems like it's pretty easy, but what's important is from perspective of challenges that we faced, I like what you, Asanka mentioned about base layered architecture. Because you have the traditional IT, the ERPs of the world, and all of that, that has a particular delivery life cycle, might be 3-monthly life cycle, right? Now, how do you now layer that against the innovation layer, where you have 3-week life cycle, right? You have a much faster pace of innovation at that layer, and now there's always friction when it comes to that layer meeting the other layer. So there's a whole bunch of things that you have to do in order to make sure that is smoother. One part of is this technical, which is the infrastructure. Now, in order to for us to get to that journey, we have to make sure that our infrastructure is sorted out, which includes MDM layer, API management, the services integration layer. All of that has to be done at an enterprise level. And so right now, in fact, we are deploying WSO2 API manager to solve one part of that problem. And before that, we use the integration services of WSO2. So these are all very important elements of creating that digital platform for the enterprise. And without that, you're really, it's like spaghetti, right? You will really hit a roadblock wall very, very soon. So once you do that part, the next challenge is really at an organization level. So how do you, first of all, how do you really create some of those connections between the base layers? When there's a very critical use case or user journey that requires changes to the bottom layer, can you wait 3 months to get it done? Can you change the processors there to make sure that there's a swim lanes, different swim lanes, right? So all of those changes are also very, very necessary as part of your digital journey. So I think the interesting thing is, so there's another part of it, which is the technology challenges, like the cloud, analytics. One thing I find is the mindset change. Every enterprise now has to become like a product company. Every service they put out, a product company doesn't just create products and just let it be, right? They analyze the customers, they analyze the usage, all of that. Now enterprises have to build those competencies. Enterprises had a captive audience all this time. They build a product and put it out to the enterprise, they better use it. If they have a checklist of functionality, all the functionality is met, they better use it. Doesn't matter how the user experience is. Now it's no longer that way, right? They have to incent their customers, which is internal customers sometimes, and they have to run on a different set of metrics now to engage that and motivate that behavior. So there's a whole different set of competencies that have to be developed within the organizations to almost run like a product company or set of product companies. All those competencies in analytics, usage analytics, marketing, digital marketing, all of that has to be used even internally within an enterprise. So I think that's a very specific set of things that you can do to really overcome some of those challenges. It's an exciting place.
So Ramesh, what would you say with the key challenges that you face then?
Challenges. I think the biggest challenge, as I said, we've been an SAP shop since 2004, right? All our 70 companies run on a consolidated ERP, including the hotels, run on a platform called Indra, which is on the PMS, which is built on SAP. So 50% of our business is end-to-end runs on SAP, right? So one of the challenge that you would see in today's context that the linear value chain is moving to a value ecosystem, right? I think if you look at the Uberization of the world, if you so to speak, now today, if I want to buy something, I'll probably take my mobile, log into Amazon, order a book, pay by PayPal, get it shipped by DHL. So I create my value chain, right? DHL doesn't determine that, Amazon doesn't determine that, PayPal doesn't determine that, right? So today, the challenge for us as a traditional organization is, who got you so much to a linear value chain, how do you now facilitate the value ecosystem the customer is demanding from us, right? So that's where the two-speed IT comes in, the bimodal IT. So the mode one is what our ERP, the traditional transactional based thing that we are running. The mode two is the agility that we are looking for. So I don't know whether you all remember when Uber came in, they offered Uber Shopper. I don't know how many of you guys saw that. Now, if you don't have the kind of agility to map your product, to launch a service like that for a week and take it off, right? I don't think without that mode two, you'll be able to do that. Right? Today, a lot of our organizations are unable to do that, right? So that's the reason now we are trying to bring in an API layer to orchestrate and federate and create an ecosystem with partners and expand beyond the boundaries of John Case in terms of offering a consumer what he wants. So the challenge there is twofold. Like a lot of us here would understand what technology can do, right? But going to a boardroom and tell them, you know, if you say API, they say, what the hell is API? Like open source, right? So the challenge is how do you, in a business sense, convince them that there is a business case and there's a business need for this transformation, right? So obviously, one of the things that we did for the last 2 years, I personally have been talking a lot about digital disruption, public forums at John Keells, and last year, actually, we had a planned intervention with National University of Singapore, NUS. With the initiative, we picked 30 young guys across the group and put them through a program, 6 months program. And about 6 months back, we had a kickoff, a huge digitalization initiative across the group, where every CEO was mandated that they have to identify digital initiatives and potential disruptions which are happening in the world which are relevant to their industry. And they were supposed to make a board paper to the board and create awareness amongst their colleagues. So that's the way currently we are undergoing. The whole theme is called increasing the digital quotient, right? So we wanted every employee in the organization to be digitally aware, right? This is what could potentially happen to my business. This is what I could potentially do to my customer to enrich or the experience, right? So today we are actually going through that way. While doing that, we do certain phenomenal stuff that we've done. I don't know, probably would have seen in the papers. We got actually the Sapphire Innovation Award in Orlando last year. Because what we did was, we just to show that to John Case that this is real and this is doable today, we actually integrated iBeacons, Google Glass at Cinnamon Grad. We did a PO proof of concept. We planted iBeacons at the, say, front office, coffee shop. So we used the OpenID, and through Facebook login, we populated the consumer's thing when he did the registration, when he booked a hotel room. So when he walks into the hotel with a mobile app, if you're a Domino's Cinnamon app, we can detect that he's at the front office. And the front office officer would get alerted on the Google Glass, this person has arrived on the Google Glass, right? So person could walk up to the guest, greet that guest by name, right? Then the same person goes to the coffee shop. But Google Glass is so prohibitive, it's not practical, but we did it as a theoretical exercise. So if the guy who is serving your coffee is wearing a Google Glass, he'll also probably be able to see this guy so-and-so. And what are his preferences? What did he order last time? From Facebook, we even scrape his preferences. What food does he like? Is he a vegetarian? Is he a vegan? Or does he like certain kind of food? And we were able to offer personalized even menu cards if we want to. So the concept is, what we said is, today the power of the technology is real, right? But what do you want to do with it? Where do you want to go with it? It's a question that business have to decide. We can't decide. We are a means to an end. Business have to ultimately buy it. They got to invest in it and they got to make it work. So today the biggest challenge that I see is organizations are not ready to use this technology in the biggest sense from a Sri Lankan context, because our maturity level from a customer demand, customers are not demanding more. And our organizations feel that, hey, the current status quo will prevail for another 2 years. What's the hurry, right? So this chicken and egg debate is what is probably killing us. And if you educate more people, and I think more people get aware that this is real and this is doable, I'm sure we can build the traction.
Does that reflect your experience, Conrad?
Yeah, I think I agree with Ramesh with regards to the readiness of the business. I think that's something the leadership of the organization has to take it. That's something that which we also face when it comes to digitalization and using the technology in the business. I'll share some experience with regards to mobile app for the customers, because we have a couple of things. We have done one mobile solution for the digital platform for our microfinancing officers, which is actually the employees of the organization. They go into the rural areas and they do microfinancing. Microfinancing means not the microservices, it's microfinancing. It's actually the financing of smaller financing amounts, like in Sri Lankan rupee context, it's about 25,000 rupees for self-employed and a group loan concept. So the challenge there, what we faced is actually our guys earlier used to go and, you know, get the loan documents and do the loan through manual means. Today, now they go with an they go with a mobile app and a printer, and they do the entire processing, including now the credit appraisal process. That means giving the credit to the end user itself through that whole process managed through the mobile app. But again, we have a huge challenges there. The connectivity was an issue in the whole rural areas, because we are talking about deep rural. We are not talking about Colombo. We are not talking about the main towns where there is connectivity. So we have to look at the challenges which we face in terms of how we go. I mean, it's not a digital through a digital challenge, but the connectivity issue. Then the physical money that which is being carried back to the office, there's a huge risk. Whether there is a digital component of it, or whether there is a, we talked about digital money sometime back or a couple of weeks ago in another forum. So how can that be transformed is a question that we had. So when it comes to the customer app, we have all walks of customers. If you really look at it, the rural community doesn't have a smartphone yet. They are not using smartphone. So how can we give this opportunity of them to use the mobile banking platform, transfer money without a mobile digital true smartphone? So we had to invest, or we had to look at, that's a customer experience at the end of the day. It's a different form of customer, but that customer is not expecting a smartphone experience, so he's expecting something else. So we had to look at the US investment in USSD, which I don't know, some of y'all wouldn't have heard of, which is a bit of an older technology, and we had to do an app on USSD as well. So that's another experience that we had. So then the other challenge that we had in terms of we are a running organization, meaning that we do have to maintain our day-to-day operations. We need to adhere to the governance things in the organization because of a finance organization, and we need to find a mechanism of how do we deliver this digital platform while we are doing the on the traditional platform. So we need to look at something differently, and we carved out two teams for that. Actually, we call it, I don't know, on the BCG, Boston Consultants Group say two-speed IT kind of a concept, and Gartner is saying, I think, some other, bimodal IT, right? So similar concept that we adopted, we looked at, carved out a technical team who will do this faster delivery, faster technology using different things, and the other team of people. So that's another challenge that we face, which we are facing, still we are facing with the integrations. I think thanks to like the ESP and all that, we solve it to a certain extent. That's another challenge that we came across when we are rolling it out. Of course, the technology challenges are not that great in terms of, I mean, there are no that much of technology challenges. It's readiness and how you adopt it, and how do you give the business what they need with the real ROI. I think one of the other challenges is, even though that we are ready with the technology, whether, I don't know how many of you knew that you can use a mobile banking platform of Lankorix Finance Company or commercial leasing company and transfer money to any other bank, even on a poor day, even middle of the night, right? So that's a huge issue that we have. So there is another challenge in terms of communication challenges that we have. So these are the business challenges that which we have faced so far, and we are now trying to roll it out, how we are going to market it. Because I think I can say that we are the only company or only banking sector company who can facilitate that at this given moment. Not even a bank has it at this given moment, right? So a classic use case is on a poor day, if you want to buy something, and if your seller's account is in commercial bank of Ceylon or any other bank, most of the banks are covered now, almost 12 banks are on the platform. Going with your mobile phone, if you have an account with Lankorix Finance, you can give the money and do the transaction even on a poor day, even up to 5 million rupees, which is a huge amount of money you're talking about. It's not a small amount. 5 million rupees means you can buy a car. But the challenges are, have we educated the users? Have they adopted it? The user adaptation is a challenge. So these are some digital challenges that you are facing now.
So a lot of food for thought. I guess we've been speaking for about 30 minutes now. Time has come for you to start speaking and asking some questions to our panel here have a lot of experience, so I'm sure they can address pretty much any question you throw at them. Do we have any volunteer or anything on Twitter happening? I'm going to put some light on you now so we can see you same way you see us. Anybody? We just need one volunteer. There you go. Just wait for a microphone to come to you. Minora.
Thank you for sharing your insights. Very interesting. So I know all of you manage large IT teams, software developers, and you all are managing these transformation projects. So I wanted to hear a little bit about the people aspects of it, because you talked about two-pace development, bimodal IT. So you're talking about two very different kinds of people engaging. And how do you manage that?
We actually have taken on a very liberal approach in terms of on the mode two. We are partnering a lot of organizations, including freelancing guys, right? Because thanks to Sanjeev, I come for this work in Sri Lanka, and I meet a lot of guys. And today, actually, we're having a few big data initiatives which are done by guys who are just relocated from US, right? So we are not looking for formal structures and organizations, but we are looking for capabilities, and we are crowdsourcing it today for Mode 2. So that's where we feel anyone and everyone should be able to contribute to Mode 2, and that's where we are trying to provide the architecture and the fail-safe, fail-fast kind of thing, where we could do things iteratively, see how we could improve, learning from the startups in terms of minimum viable product, what's it? If it's successful, how do I take it to the next level? That kind of thought process.
Add to that, I think there's some, we said two-speed IT or bimodal IT, but I think we need to understand managing people is, you should not say that the low-speed one is not important and the high-speed one is the only important one. I mean, that message should not go. I think both things are important for the organization. So it's a transition stage. So I think the more focus should be in terms of the higher speed or the digital speed is to give a digital speed solution, and they are important as well as the core system providers or the core system guys. Of course, we also use outsource services from various parties, various organizations.
Yeah, so we have a slightly different situation where we are having a lot of developers and very IT savvy organization in general. So one of the challenges that we have comes from the IT side itself, because we have most of the technologies that have been brought up in the system have a mindset of building the solution is the biggest challenge, right? They think building some solution, you know, they try to delve into the technical areas and technical challenges and all of that, and without really thinking about what challenge are they trying to solve, and what do you want to achieve, because they expect somebody else to do that thinking. Now you want an IT organization that really, really changes that mindset and starts experimenting much more, and really thinking about the business objective and collaboratively working with the business to achieve business outcomes. And sometimes you do that with things like minimum viable product. You know, there's a lean startup. All of those methodologies now have to come into the picture, and these are competencies that the IT guys don't have today. Right? That's one of the biggest challenges that we need to face, and those are competencies that we need to impart. And sometimes certain processes and trainings need to be done in order to make sure that we elevate the IT organizations to start thinking that way, almost like entrepreneurs. Right? The entire IT organization has to be like entrepreneurs. Take some risks, you know, really do some experiments and really figure out what the path is, rather than, you know, wait for somebody to give the requirements and get it done.
I couldn't agree more. Sometimes it's the IT group is the devil in itself. There's a lot of solutions that can be done, and sometimes it's really hard. In our group, we're containing the education first in the IT team, and once we're happy with that, then we'll go to the other business units.
My question is related to two parts. First is on the user side or the customer side. And second is on the analysis side. So typically when you talk about the user side of the story, when we are talking about any digital experience, we need to take into account, you know, not only basically guys who are living in city, but villagers as well, right? So the first challenge that I typically see in today's environment is the farmers are not very well connected with the cities, right? So they need to ship goods, need to basically get some of the basic elementary services. So at the moment, you know, digital experience is not really helping them. So point number one, how we can enable basically a proper communication between the people who are living in villages and the guys who are actually living in the city with a connected enterprise, point number one. Then point number two is, if you look at overall customer perspective, there is a lot of basically 360 degree analysis which are to be done on the back end side to understand what really a particular customer wants. So how you can achieve those 360 degree, you know, analysis using the existing technology or whatever is coming in future. So those are the two questions I have.
Very loaded question. I don't know, we have just 5 minutes. I think if you look at the challenge today from a Sri Lankan context, is I think our mobile penetration is close to about 90%. And like what Conrad said, smartphone penetration is only about 30%, right? So the any digitalization strategy has to look at USSD to reach the masses. So the options in terms of what you could do is limited, right? If you really only vehicle we would have to reach the masses on inclusive sustainable development is mobile, right? Because broadband penetration is only like 20%. So the given that challenge, the biggest issue is how do you even get. Now, if you look at from a Sri Lankan context, EC cash, mobile cash has caught a bigger traction because of that very reason. And today, if you look at an average ARPU, and 90% of our mobile phones are prepaid, and average ARPU is about $3. That's about $400, right? So when you have a wallet which is $400 only, what can you do with it, right? So there's not too many options that you could do in terms of selling big things, right? So it is ultimately for digitalization to really take off, our per capita income has to grow, right? The economic activity has to grow. There has to be a higher disposable income at the lower bottom of the pyramid, right? And I think India has bypassed that thing, and probably you have the critical mass in India to do that. In Sri Lanka, still we are struggling to get the critical mass. So whatever we do is purely pitching at the top end of the tier, right? And purely creating engagement experience. Not in terms of the inclusive thing. I don't know if I answer that in a short sense.
Yeah, so I would like to add to that as well. Like, so whatever the digital experience that you are providing should be based on the underneath infrastructure. So it can, like, ideally it should be real time and those the features that I explained, but it can be batched. As an example, like, you can utilize the existing infrastructure or network. Like, as an example, I think, I'm not sure whether it exists now, there was a system to do trading in these villages, that people go to the post office and then do the trading. So it's kind of a digital experience for them based on the available infrastructure, and then provide it as a service. So you have to pick the correct method or correct solution based on the available infrastructure. Still, you can provide some value for your customers.
Hi. We've spoken about digital transformation, and that's often driven by a technology group or technologists. You've already mentioned that it's an enterprise sort of initiative and we need to bring the business along. I guess my question is, do you have any advice on techniques or methods to bring those stakeholders on the journey that works? You know, it's something that you've often had to deal with, so.
You mean to say getting the business folks into the journey, is it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's got to be an enterprise initiative. That's really what's got to happen. But it's often started by technologists, and getting that business on the journey, getting them there is a hard thing. I just wondered if you've got techniques or advice on what's worked for you guys.
I think Ramesh touched upon it. I just want to say something before, I mean, he can explain that further. I think one of the things that we need to know, we are talking about this bimodal IT and all that. I think we need to go into the bimodal business as well. In the sense, if your business leaders doesn't understand the digital, what the digital business can do and how it is, how it can help your organization, definitely this, the new disrupting companies will come and take over your. So I think in a, from a business perspective also, I think the businesses needs to look at whether we could look at a bimodal business, in the sense the digital channel separately and then trying to build that digital business, because it's still in the infancy stage. That's my opinion, and probably if you can drive towards that so that you have a digital business line with the supported with the digital IT platform and going towards that, I think might help achieving that. I think Ramesh touched upon something else in terms of how you all have done it.
I think it's difficult, it's organization centric, right? A lot of this stuff is very personal to the organization and the culture and the leadership. So if I speak for John Keells, the first, when you're running mode one, that's the ERP, you got to first earn your credibility as a technology team, having established a kind of a well-oiled transaction system. You can't be talking about digital when your transaction system is falling apart, right? So first you got to establish that foundation, earn that credibility, then you can take the journey of having the discussion about digitalization specific things. Now, if you look at from a John Keells point of view, as I said, now today we run a virtual environment. Like I think they were talking a lot about today, I can provision a VM in 5 minutes, right? I run a virtual environment on Cisco VCS, NetApps, VMware. So I couldn't even fail over my data center in 10 minutes, all my servers, right? So the issue is about when you establish a credibility, people are going to listen to you, right? But then, because the issue is, no one is going to write a blank check and give you go do whatever you want, right? I don't think that's going to happen in any organization. So then you got to pick your battles in terms of the 80 businesses, who is the business who is really kind of not doing too well, and this could really be the game changer for them. So if you pick your battles in terms of maybe getting few business cases established, say this is going to work, then the rest will, like as the floodgates open, they will buy in. So obviously you need to have a sponsor at a board level. That's important. For us, fortunately, our chairman himself sits on the digitalization committee as a chairman, right? So which is a good thing for us, because when you have that kind of buy-in, it's very easy to drive initiatives. But when you don't have that buy-in at the C-level, at the board level, it will be a challenge. So it's important to get the sponsor and work with him to get things going.
So I think it's also important to get the mindset shifted. And sometimes it's good to get a consultant, sometimes get the business guys into a room, really help create that paradigm shift in their mind, that it's a new world. I think that's really important to do that homework upfront, because it really opens their eyes to the opportunities and opportunities to come. That's a really important step in this direction. Otherwise, they all have heard about the buzzwords, doesn't really know how it applies to them or to their careers and all of that. I think that's something very important to achieve initially.
And avoid jargon. Avoid the acronyms, talk business language. I think that works.
Yeah. Well, finish on that note. I like that one. So, thank you very much for your attention. And please give a big round of applause for the team here. And this, thank you very much.